We open the post-lunch session with new fiction, readings and conversations. Well-known authors Amitava, Kumar and Janice Pariat will discuss and read from their latest books. With them, we have writer, journalist, dancer, stage actor and comedian Nandini Krishnan. I welcome them onto the stage.
Hi everyone, welcome to the first post-lunch session with Amitava Kumar and Janice Pariat. I'm glad both of you are on this panel. Strangely, your novels are almost exact counterpoints to each other. I was in fact wondering if yours had 9 chapters, but the 9th chapter remains unwritten as of now. Amitava, speaking of Agnes Medley's work, you say it is neither a memoir nor simply a novel, and I think that encapsulates what both of you have written, because you, of course, have been asked repeatedly whether it's autobiographical, and you've even arrived at an exact percentage, 57.8%, right? Yeah. But then let me start with your trajectory as a writer. Your first book, Boats on Land, was a much vaster landscape where you explored various things from mythology to personal narrative to plays. And from there, of course, there was Seahorse, which was shortlisted for the Hindu's Fiction Award. And now this book, which is something of a novella and also uniquely a second person novel.
I think if I'm to speak of the nine-chambered heart, it's many things. It's an experiment. It's a literary experiment for me. It's also, at the risk of sounding extremely cheesy, also a work that comes very much from the heart. And in a way, it's also a book that's a little bit of a rebellion. I think I started writing feeling as though I very much was telling stories of a particular place. Mm-hmm. So Boats on Land, if there is a spectrum to this at all, Boats on Land is on one end of the spectrum, and it's a collection of short stories that are very, very profoundly and deeply linked to the northeast of India. They're stories that couldn't have been set anywhere else. And Seahorse, which was my second novel, follows a similar kind of geographical alignment between Delhi and London and all of that. Nine-Chambered Heart, I suppose, falls on the far end of the spectrum, in the sense that it is geographically loose and unanchored, and the book, in a way, floats across borders and boundaries. And I think for me, it was really important to kind of break free of a certain kind of label that had been quite frequently slapped on me as a Northeast woman writer, writing about a particular place, being the voice of a community, about which I have nothing against, for people who do find that pertinent to their writing. But for me, it was important to also claim some sort of freedom. And I think Nine-Chambered Heart helped me in a way to do that.
Amitava, in your work, of course, you explore themes of migration over the years. I mean, themes of migration, and you've always sort of played on this space between memoir and novel, and you know, taking off from real events. Several of your narrators have had similar lives to the extent journalists have asked you specifically about husband of a fanatic, and you know. With this novel, I get the feeling that it was something which you wanted to write for a very long time, perhaps right from when you started your career in writing.
Yeah. I should first of all say that this panel is called New Fiction, and it means that I think the program folks might have thought that we have come out with new books, so it's new fiction. But I also want to say, and this might seem like a generalization to many people, but I think new fiction in this time and age has to be a mix of memoir, reportage, and story. It's a wide generalization, but I do want to make it. So that's the background against which I want to answer that question. Yeah, long time ago, 25 years ago maybe, I was in a train in New York, and I remembered the monkeys that used to climb on my maternal uncle's balcony in Ara. Cool? And something that happened with a gun, and the monkey probably getting hold of the gun. And I wrote that piece down, and now so many years later, it became the starting point for this story. And why it did? Because I read in a newspaper that the monkeys that were appearing in different places in Delhi were the result of monkeys being exported over many years to the US for scientific experiments, till Morarji Desai asked, why are they being used for scientific experiments? But, and to end my long-winded answer, it was also discovered that much of the space journeys that happened, explorations that happened in their early forms only had these monkeys, and the monkeys were from India. So I tried to weave them all together.
In fact, there's a reference much later on when you speak about how an Indian worker for the Democratic Party is referred to as a monkey, basically, by a Republican. And I think that context is even more important in today's America, where racism is largely the norm, I mean, sanctioned by the White House, and the White House is actually the White House. So, Janice, of course, with the 57, back to the 57.8% autobiography. But, I mean, of course, you in this particular novel, the places don't have names. We have geographies, the city by the river, the city without the sea, the city with, yeah. So there are various indications of where these places are, and some are very clear markers, such as a cathedral, which anyone who has seen pictures of it will recognize. I'm not giving too much away. But when your character has followed a geographical trajectory and perhaps a career trajectory, which is similar to yours, were there any points at which you consciously had to disconnect so that you could be the writer and not the narrator and not the subject?
So you're right, it's undeniably a very intimate book, but it still is called a novel, it's still fiction and not a memoir, and I think that it does honor those distinctions, even if some parts less so than others. And you're right, there are moments within the book where I did make a rather conscious decision, whether it came to physical appearance or even vocation or the way that the central protagonist reacts to people around her. I did try and quite pointedly make them foreign to myself or alien to myself. So, as you said, to distinguish her from me and me from her. But I think above and beyond that, and perhaps even more than that, was how to use narrative technique. So for me, it was really quite important to arrive at some sort of narrative way, some sort of narrative style that, yes, echoed thematically what the book was about, but also helped me do that. So I thought that actually writing in first person for this book would have helped it slide into memoir territory quite rapidly. So it was quite a conscious, and well, it took me a long time to come to this narrative technique by the end of it, and I was telling Amitava of this a couple of days ago, but it was really important for me to do that, that the mode of addressal, for those of you who might not have read the book, the mode of addressal is one of nine people all speaking about one person, and she's at the center of the narrative, and she doesn't have a voice, and they all address her as you. And that, I think, helped me maintain the distance for myself and also for the reader.
Unlike Janice, Amitava, there is an I, but then we learn very clearly on that this character has a name, Kailash, and therefore is not to be confused with the author. But then with your footnotes, you've sort of deliberately mixed it up where some of them are your notes, some of them are the narrator's notes. So there's this whole, but you do draw very specific distinctions where, of course, this guy gets me-too'd, which you haven't so far as far as I'm aware. And then he also has a very different lifestyle. He's not married when we last meet him. Maybe you'd like to speak a little bit about this. You started off about new fiction and how it has to straddle these various genres. So maybe you could speak a little bit about your interest in it. And you've always liked sort of occupying that ambiguous space. So what does that give you and what does it give the reader?
Boss, I think we take literature too seriously. And it should be a more playful exercise. And one of the things people should play with is the idea of authorship. And we should also play with the idea of this artificial boundary between fiction and non-fiction. So that in the world of fiction, real things that happen come flooding in. Or if you're writing non-fiction, you have a great sense of how it is a narrative, how you're arranging it in the same way as you would do in a novel. So that's the first thing. A second thing, you know, there's a whole tradition of people like, let's say, Nabokov's memoir, which is Pale Fire, one of the best memoirs ever. It was published actually as fiction in one side of the Atlantic and as non-fiction on the other side of the Atlantic. The modern inheritors of that sort of play are people like Jeff Dyer, who always says something which I adore, which is all my writing is within an inch of the reality and all the art is in that one inch. That's amazing to me. That everything should be so close to life, but also there should always be that distance, just that little play. So my attempt to play with, as you were saying, you know, my narrator is called Kailash. He's in New York as a student. One of his friends, an Irish fellow, calls him Kalashnikov. Some people laugh at it, so he starts calling that AK-47, and the guy becomes AK, which I know is also the initials of the writer of this book. So I was just, you know, joking around. And I think that's a good thing to do because our compatriots, whether they are writing, sending a job application or when they are writing literature, are often very, 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 very serious. They're all readers of the Hindu, you know? And you want them to be lighten up.
Maybe we can...
Which probably explains why people take it so seriously when I say, yes, yes, it's 57.8% autobiographical, I assure you.
We're all trying to divide something by 9 to arrive at the 0.8, honestly. And it's very hard. So maybe we can start by reading from the first story, sure. Which is called The Saint. Mm-hmm. Because again, another thing, which a common thread is the idea of the teacher. Which is your first chapter and which is runs as a thread throughout your book, first through Ehsan and later through the narrator. But we'll come to that first. Maybe you could read.
So the first section is called The Saint and it allows you to encounter the protagonist when she's a schoolgirl. And I'll read you a little bit from it. Almost a year ago, on my first day here in this small school, in this small town in the east of the country, I assigned the class to paint a tree. What kind of tree, you asked. Any kind, I replied, but there are so many kinds of trees. I'm happy with any. That did not please you, and while you sat there undecided, the others dipped and dabbed, and I could tell that when you eventually tried, you were ashamed, even a little humiliated, that your tree looked like a green popsicle on a stick. I made the mistake of coming round to your side of the table and praising the girl to your right. Look, look how she's allowed some sky to filter through the branches. That's how it is, isn't it? A tree is patchy. There are gaps between the leaves. You stared at me with something quite close to hatred. It's a look I grew accustomed to those first few months. Everything I said, whether to you or another student, seemed incendiary. You didn't commit any overt misdemeanors, nothing I could throw you out of class for, which perhaps would have made it easier. Instead, it was a simmering, furtive mutiny. You did the barest minimum of work, spending most of class time staring listlessly or excusing yourself to use the loo and not returning until just before the bell. You wouldn't care to participate or answer questions, and anything I asked directly was met with a moody, I don't know. In this way, we plowed on through the year. And even today, I get the same look of loathing. We're painting a snowy landscape in class, and I glance at the picture you've made and say sharply, "Have you ever seen pure white in nature?" And you frown. "What do you mean?" "I mean, snow is not white. White, is it? There's shades of blue and gray and pink. The white wouldn't show if it were only white." And then I make the biggest mistake of all. I touch up your painting. I dip the paintbrush in a bit of blue and black and water, and I spread it over the landscape, a touch here, a stroke there. I have improved the picture, but lost you. From then on, you refuse to pick up a brush. Even on threat of punishment and failure, you are the most stubborn child I know and make me long for the days of corporal punishment. Later, when I ask the class to hand in their assignments for grades, you submit a blank page. "What is this?" I ask crossly. "White birds flying through white clouds."
You know, when I read this story, I had to sort of examine my own prejudices, because I made this assumption that the teacher was, the narrator was yes. You, a version of you, you know. So I saw her very much with your face, yeah. And though I tried to disconnect it in my head and say, okay, narrator, I mean, don't be stupid. But I saw the person as a she, and I saw the student as a boy, and for little boys to have crushes on their teachers is very common, so it didn't seem troubling at all. But then later in the story, you realize it's a girl, and you still think it's okay, a girl crush, but then you realize later in the book that the teacher was male. Mm-hmm. And there are no clear indicators in the story, and I asked you when we spoke yesterday whether you always knew that the teacher was a he. So the thing is, what it did to me later was it was very troubling in a sense, because there's this little girl who's, this is her first experience of love, mm-hmm. and just because of, maybe because of anatomy, because of things that have happened in the past, because pedophilia is something we speak about now but not earlier, there are various shades to the teacher's feelings towards this little girl too. So in a sense, that story became very disturbing later on in the book for me. Mm. So maybe you could speak about that aspect of it. Did it strike you as you were writing, or did it come back to you later? Mm-hmm. How did it work?
I think, to be honest, I'm going to pick up where Amitav actually left off earlier about the idea of playfulness. I think even with gender, there is a certain playfulness to gender that we can sort of, you know, latch on to. That is it a male? Is it female? Does it matter? And I think you're right that perhaps it plays a much more important part later on in the book. But at the beginning, it is about this young person's desire for affection, for attention, from this particular figure of authority. That this figure of authority turns out to be male and her female, of course, you find out later, and that perhaps makes it a sort of a double back for you, where you have to go back to it. But honestly, for me, and even all through Seahorse and with this novel, gender is also something to be played with and to sort of have fun with. Because as Philip Pullman says, we're a little bit of everything. We are male and we are female and we are wise and we are stupid and we can be old and we can be young. And I think that's a good sort of way to go with it, to play.
On the subject of the teacher, Amitava, the teacher is such a powerful figure whom, and we always encounter these teachers in schools or universities, one particular person whom the students are extremely fond of, you know, I mean, Dead Poets Society was based entirely on something like that, who relates to the students whom you want to emulate. And in your book, the lovers, in a sense, of course, this is only the Indian title of the book, the title in other countries is Immigrant Montana, and you'll have to read the book to find out why. But in a sense, the students are also lovers of Ehsan in a way. So maybe you could speak about the character of Ehsan, who of course draws, you've said in the book, from Iqbal Ahmed, but also as a teacher yourself, with experience of interacting with students, and I'm sure with experience of students who seek to emulate you in some sense, what have you brought to the character? What has the character given you?
You know, there is no one in this room who doesn't have a teacher, who hasn't had a teacher. And not only, so that's in a general sense, but also if you're an artist, or if you're a writer, actor, photographer, your teachers are not simply those you've encountered in the classroom. Your teachers are those who have left on you their influences. Just this morning, you know, Vivek Shanbhag is sitting there. Just this morning, I was telling him that for him to have the presence of people like Anantamurthy and Ramanujan and others in his life for a long period of time is a great gift. I've had distant models, you know. I have not worked as an apprentice under someone, but I wish I did. It's a great gift, I think, and a curse sometimes. So I was interested in the character who Nandini described as a teacher because he seemed to embody to me an exemplary cosmopolitanism. He was a man, an actual man, born in a village in Bihar. When he was 5, he saw his father killed next to him. He was from a Muslim family. He migrated. He had to walk across from Delhi to Lahore during the partition. He got a scholarship to Princeton. While doing his PhD in Tunisia, he became involved in the Algerian struggle and then in the Palestinian struggles. When he came back with his PhD in America, he was arrested for conspiring to kidnap Kissinger. Amazing life. People like Edward Said dedicated their books to him. Now, what would it have meant to have a model like that in your life? So that's my first question. My first attempt to have that in place to almost overcome a lack that I felt in my own life. And the second part of it, which will be shorter, is that I also realized from my own experience that Indian students, Pakistani students, Chinese students, working with other figures in America, you know, in their departments, would have these ideal figures to look up to, but their own lives were very messy. Mine certainly was, you know. So how to portray young lives, confused lives, like constellations around something that is steadier, a fixed star. That is what the teacher meant to me.
Right. So Ehsan, in a way, I think the part which I found most fascinating in him was when he speaks about portable homelands. And it's too long a section to do justice to in reading, so I'll just summarize it.
Everyone should just buy the book.
Yeah, just buy the book.
It is difficult to summarize. Yeah.
But I'll make an attempt. The most poignant scene for me, because I literally saw it, was there are all these Palestinian refugees who have had to leave their homes in a hurry. And they take their keys with them. They lock the doors and take the keys with them. And long after they know their homes are destroyed, they still keep the keys, because keys to locks which don't exist anymore, which guard homes which don't exist anymore. And that was just such a, it left me feeling so empty. And I think soon after that, you have this one section which you could perhaps read out for them, on where you start speaking about, it's page 39, where you start speaking about Ehsan sitting in a chair with his hurt leg raised.
Coming down the steps outside his apartment building, Ehsan fell down and twisted his ankle. Walking turned out to be difficult for him, and our seminar temporarily shifted to his home. We still had the wine and the plastic cups. The subjects of discussion that day were issues of displacement and exile, focused on the writings of Edward Said, Asia Jabbar, and Anton Shamas. By the way, this is just the right section, again, as I said, for Hindu readers, because this is about an academic discussion and is, in my opinion, dull and boring, but it's very good, very good. You're right. One of the students in the seminar, Negin, who was Iranian and had grown up in Los Angeles, said she had really liked Jabbar. There is no exile for women. When women lose their country and live somewhere else, the customs of the old country follow them there. They are never able to escape it. Negin's mother had said to Negin's elder sister, who was studying law, "Don't be a whore." The mother wanted a marriage in which the family would play a part, but the sister was fighting back. Like one of Jabbar's characters, Negin's sister told her parents, "I won't marry." Ehsan was sitting in a chair with his hurt leg raised and resting on a stool. He tilted his head toward Negin as she told her story, and then when she stopped, he told us about his mother. When Ehsan left his village, Irki, in 1947, to accompany refugees going across to Pakistan, his mother stayed back in India. Her exile was different from Jabbar's. Ehsan said his mother saw the people who were fighting for Pakistan as reactionary and insufficiently anti-colonial. That was one side of the picture. On the other side, unlike Ehsan's older brothers who had eager plans about what they wanted to do in the new country, their mother was faced with a simple task. Ehsan's sister Abba had fallen sick. She had typhoid. I said earlier that, you know, there should be that little inch between life and reality, but here, this is just half an inch, because I've just used the interviews with his family. My mother decided to take care of my sister, who would not have been able to make that arduous journey. "When did you see them again?" Negin asked. "I didn't. Not my sister, at least. She died. This was about 10, 11 years later. I saw my mother then. She came to Pakistan for a while before returning again to the village in India. She had liked the life there. We brought her back when she fell ill. She died in Pakistan." He became silent. I thought of my mother in Patna. She was waiting for me to come back after I had received my degree. Soon, she would be old too. And my grandmother in the village, whom I could see in my mind's eye placing two or three red hibiscus flowers on the shrine in her courtyard. The shrine was a dark stone, no bigger than a fist, on a brick and cement pedestal about 4 feet high that had projecting from it a tall bamboo with a red jhandi on the top. Boss, when do you want me to finish?
Just keep reading the whole book. No, I think that'll do.
Okay, thank you.
I'm not going to give away which character this is, but you know, when we move abroad to study or to live for a while or whatever, it is the greatest fear which everyone has is that someone back home will die. So every phone call at an odd time is scary, and at the time that the narrator lives there, phone calls are not easy to make. So when someone has made the effort to come out and make that call, you know that something bad has happened. So I think another thing which you both have in common is this whole thing of there are various geographies involved. But what I noticed in your book, Janice, was that while the protagonist, not the narrator in your sense, but the subject doesn't belong to any place, but every place seems to belong to her. Whereas, Amitava, you speak very poignantly about the fact that no place seems to belong to that person. All of us become in-between people where you can't be happy going back, and you're not happy where you are also. So that's a, maybe you could speak a little bit about how maybe not belonging anywhere, in a sense, gives her the liberty to make every place her own.
Right. Well, there's a couple of things with that. I think, like I said, right at the beginning of the conversation, that this was a little bit of a rebellious book. And I actually wanted to push the story to see what would happen if I take away geographical trappings. What happens to a story when you take away context? And we know these stories. We know the fairy tales that sort of travel across borders really easily. Arabian Nights, you know, our mythologies that kind of move and drift across countries and continents. There's a certain lightness to them that enable them to do this. And I'd been quite fascinated actually with that idea, that what kind of stories survive this? What kind of stories survive being unanchored? What kind of stories survive being sort of cut loose? What does it do to the story? Does it transform them? Does it make it a different story? How do you tell a story in this way? Mm-hmm. And I think actually that's how I went with this nowhereness that kind of exists with the book. And I think that makes her, like the story itself, drift across borders.
And before I toss that to you, Amitava, there's this one section which, again, which has to do with the narrator finding a book which says The Quilt and Other Stories by Isma Chugtai outside a bookstore. And since this is amongst a lot of other books from other countries, somehow this book, which is from his own country, in a sense, speaks to him. And I'm just going to read out a very short section, a couple of sentences, really. So where he reads the book, he starts reading the book in English. And he says, I passed my hand through the pages. The reflection from the red twill lit up her bluish yellow face like sunrise. What could those words have been in the original Urdu? And the narrator and perhaps the writer wonders, what would be Urdu for bluish yellow? And from that he infers that in some sense he has become a translated man, which is such a beautiful phrase, where in a way your own culture is sort of coming back translated, and then you make of it what you will, you know. So this again is that one inch space where you're exploring emotions which a lot of us feel when we are adrift. I'm wondering what question to ask from that.
Well, let me take it somewhere. I don't remember who I stole that phrase from, translated man, but I know it was not mine.
As Jeet said yesterday, literary theft is superior to literary borrowing.
You know, if you're living, it needn't be abroad. You're from one city, you're living in another city. You want to know how the other place has changed, or you feel you're losing touch. This could apply to a person also. You're losing touch with another person. How do you begin to find more about that person? Or how do you begin to reconnect? What will you do? I'm asking that as a question to everyone. How do you connect? So, in my case, because I've been living abroad for a long time, the best way I feel I can connect with my past is by doing journalism. So every time I come back, I have a project where I go to, you know, like during my last visit, I was in Bastar. Another time I'll be in Bihar doing something. During one visit, my clothes at the hotel came back wrapped in a page of Mumbai Mirror, where I discovered that there was now a sexpert in Mumbai offering much needed sex advice. And I thought, this is something to rediscover. Not necessarily because I needed sex advice, I must clarify, but because I thought, this has changed from my time. When I was growing up, you know, you didn't have Dr. Mahinder Vatsa in the pages of Mumbai Mirror, which is, of course, I understand, different from the Hindu, offering you such advice. So if you don't mind, I could read two paragraphs.
Please. We've been waiting this far to build up to the sex.
10 years later, for the benefit of a later generation, a sex advice column in Mumbai Mirror had become popular in India. I made this discovery when my laundry came back to my hotel room wrapped in newspaper. Question. My girlfriend kissed the tip of my penis and the next day she suffered a stomach ache. Could she be pregnant? Should she take some pills? Answer. She must have had dinner afterwards and that probably led to the stomach ache. Oral sex does not cause pregnancy and she need not take any pills. There are 5 or 6 of these questions and answers. Each of them, I'm happy to report, were not imagined by me. I just copied it from the Mumbai Mirror. The good doctor, the sexpert, had once again, so I'm skipping over the rest, had once again exercised the grim matter of factness, the humor in his eyes hidden under the thick glasses he wore in the grainy photograph. And then I report about how the New York Times actually carried a report on this gentleman. His name is Dr. Mahinder Vatsa, and he recently turned 93. His editor says, this is good news for most of the geriatric people in this crowd, including me. His editor says the doctor has received more than 40,000 letters seeking advice. And if I can just read one more paragraph.
First.
The sexpert column can now be read on the internet. There was nothing like this when I was growing up in India. If at the time I could have written one, which letter would have been mine? The range of problems people present to the doctor is stunning. But yes, this one. Question. In the last semester, I failed one subject. My parents got worried and took me to an astrologer. He asked me to remove my pants. He said the ejaculate after masturbation is equal to 100 milliliters of blood, hence my weakness. I am regretting showing him my penis. Please help. Answer. The astrologer is a hoax and completely ignorant of sexual matters. Masturbation is completely normal. Visit your college counselor instead to discuss your not doing well in one subject.
So I hate to go from sex to marriage, but I must. That's the last century, Amitava. Don't get moralistic on this stage. So, you know, like in many ways, the subject of your book is seen in a complimentary manner by a lot of her lovers. But then when the husband comes in, suddenly things change, and perhaps to give them context, you would like to read the section where her husband looks at her.
Okay, but just to clarify, I think you know, all of these chapters don't comprise love affairs in the most sort of normative term. They are encounters, and they are encounters that conjure desire, and desire in all sorts of ways and coming from all sorts of spaces, from all sorts of ages and genders. So some of the chapters, this desire in a way is thwarted, or there are obstacles placed in front of it. And I think the chapter with the husband is where something of that sort takes place. Of course, we've placed a bookmark and I can't find it. Oh, here we are. Right.
We had to tear up little pieces of tissue because none of us remember to bring post-its.
No. So this is the little section from the chapter called The Lighthouse Keeper. Our wedding day comes and goes. Simple, just as we wished. A no-nonsense ceremony, a lunch, a toast. The weather held, the sun shone until late in the evening, sliding across the city in long fingers. Lovely and autumnal, I heard you say. You like words like that, autumnal. After this, there is a lull, and while I have tons of work to catch up on, you find yourself with nothing much to do. You read, you are restless, you cannot write, you're struggling with your book. I'm worried, but I don't show it. What if one morning you wake up and say, "This is not for me, I'm leaving." So I try and mollify you. There's an art show somewhere that you wish to attend, and I concede to accompanying you, even though I'm interested in it as much as I am in dung beetles. But I try keeping you happy. You get a job, too, in an office nearby, admin stuff, like updating a database and sealing envelopes. I think you will die of boredom. But it makes my heart ache to see you leave every morning, hat, coat, and gloves on, because it's freezing now. You don't complain, but of course, how can this be what anyone wants? But it's hard in this city with the river, because the rents are steep, and with only my stipend coming in, we cannot go on holiday, even after our wedding, or eat out as often as we like, or attend shows. It makes me feel I'm not enough for you. In a few months, we decide to move out to another city, this time by the sea. It's not far, it's beautiful, and more importantly, less expensive. I can come in once a week to teach my classes and meet my supervisors. You can stay home and write, I declare. I think it's like a present to you on my part, this gesture. No more silly office admin jobs. You are an artist. Your fingers are for finer things than stamps and envelopes. You acquiesce. And we move and set up house, small but charming, all wooden floors and fireplace. We pass our winter here quite happily. We discover a love for binging on movies, and I am getting to like fish and seafood, though not as much as you do. We discover a tea shop where we play Scrabble and cards. We have quiet evenings in. We drink a pint or two with acquaintances. And then one day, you ask me, don't you think we're living a life of retirement? I'm shattered. I'm pissed off. I've given you a house and everything you could possibly want in it. I just don't understand.
Before we take questions, I'll just toss one last question to you, Amitava. What do you think your narrator is sad about? You know, there's something about the narrator when we leave him which makes us think of him as sad. We feel sorry for him, we like him very much, but we don't know whether he likes himself very much. What do you make of him?
Where did you sense the sadness, if I might ask? At the end, or?
I think because he's so hopeful. He's hopeful for something, and you get the sense that it won't be fulfilled. What is he hoping for?
Well, in that sense, I should say, one of my preoccupations actually is failure. We fail. I think the story of human life is failure. Even when you succeed, you think you have failed. Just this morning, I saw there was a story in The Guardian about seven writers describing the stories of their failure. Diana Athill, Margaret Atwood, etc. So I tweeted about it saying that I failed to get into that book. But you know what I'm saying, really? Most people, for me, it's a very simple thing. So many people in Bihar, for example, where I'm from, do not have a toilet, do not have access to a toilet. If that is not failure, what is it? You know what I'm saying? Most people in the world do not have the comforts that you and I take for granted. So for me, that's life. And that life is failure. All literature can do is record it, give it a certain pattern, make a narrative out of it. And I think in some ways, I'm always interested in documenting that fact too. So maybe that is it. Not having access to a toilet. Swachh Bharat is a lie.
Perhaps we can very quickly take one question for each of the writers.
Thank you so much for taking my questions. So this is a question for Janice. But, you know, any of you could feel free to answer. So one might say that those gifted with the talent and mission of writing are also cursed with a heightened sensitization to the most excruciating and all-encompassing pain. So what was the greatest challenge for you in terms of writing this book, you know, with regard to maybe projecting a bit of yourself onto one or more characters or living the characters' feelings and emotions? Okay. And I have one more question. Can I proceed?
No, please let someone else ask. We only have time for two questions. So,
sure.
Anyone else who has a question?
My question is to Amitava. You're a writer and an academic, so you know you are teaching books, you're reading books, you're writing books. So how do you sort of approach books itself, books themselves, I mean? Do you sort of look at them as a reader, as sort of these manuals of instruction when you're teaching creative writing, or you know, as an academic, if you're writing academic articles and journals and you know, papers, you know, you sort of look at it from that critical perspective. So how do you do it, and how do you, it, you know, maintain that balance between you know these three things?
Thank you so much.
Okay, all right. So very quickly. Like I said earlier, this is definitely an intimate book. And I think just to answer your question, I might have to very quickly go back to the point at which it was conceptualized. I was walking around in London. It was very cold and wet. And I was walking around with a person who I thought I would be in a very long-term relationship with. And I found at that point that actually it had unraveled and it had ended. And I don't know if it's happened to you before where you feel as though you're standing slightly outside yourself, that you're looking at yourself from a distance and you're looking at what's happening as though in a movie. And I found myself thinking, look at you. How did you get here? What happened? And I found myself thinking about how in our lives, the people that we're with form our biography in a way, that they have stories about you and you have stories about them, and in a way we exist as narratives to each other. And I think that, while being the starting point of the novel, was also the most difficult thing for me to put on paper. What are the stories that we tell about other people, but more importantly, what are the stories that they tell about us, and how can I be honest to that?
You know, I don't read for pleasure or simply for pleasure anymore. Or the pleasure is only is primarily a critical pleasure, the pleasure of a writer and a teacher. This summer, I read a short novella called Train Dreams by an American writer, Dennis Johnson, who died this summer. And after his death, I read that story. Short novella. I read it in an afternoon, and I thought, and this is an answer to your question directly, I thought, what would it mean to write a novella? And then I thought, what would it mean to teach a course on novellas? And so I designed a course, which I'm teaching now next semester, called The World in Short. So novellas from different countries, and with your blessings, when the course is over, I'll have a novella. You know? So.
Anyone else who has questions can find them at the book signing, and authors are always happy to answer questions when they're getting royalties from you. So thank you so much, Janice. Thank you
thank
so
you.
Much, Amitava. And thank all of you for attending the session and for buying their books.